Jazakallah khairan. Inshallah, I just want to go over the format of the program just to remind you that the lecture will be, inshallah, for an hour to an hour and a half. If anyone has questions or comments, please take note of them, because we will have a question and answer session after the lecture, inshallah. And after that, we will have lunch, inshallah. And all of you are requested to join us for lunch, inshallah. A little about the brother who's speaking today. His name is Hamza Abdul Malik. He is the president of the Islamic Propagation Center International, Queens, New York. He has devoted over 25 years to the research and compilation of information on the subject of comparative religion with special interest in Christianity and theology of the New Testament as it regards the person of Jesus, peace and blessings be upon him. Mr. Malik has represented Islam in open forums in many Jewish and Christian congregations throughout America and abroad. In 1988, he attended and instructed Dawah training classes offered by the Islamic Propagation Center International in Durban, South Africa, founded by Brother Ahmed Dida. Many of his lectures and debates are available on video cassettes. His booklet, The Mission of Jesus, To Whom Was He Sent, is also available. Mr. Malik requests that you listen attentively to his speech and hold him accountable for only what he has said. My dear and beloved brother, Hamza Abdul Malik.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidul Muslimin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani rajim, bismillahi rahman rahim. Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah, wa ma'idatul hasana, wa jadilhum billati hiya ahsan. Inna rabbika huwa a'lamu biman dhala an sabilihi, wa huwa a'lamu bil muhtadin. Sadaqallah wa sadaqallahu al-azim. Mr. Chairman, my brothers and sisters in faith and in humanity, I greet you all with the greetings of peace, the greetings of Islam, the greetings of all the prophets who submitted themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to thank, first of all, the faculty and the members of the Muslim Students Association here at Queens College for inviting me. I'm deeply, deeply honored to be here. The topic this evening is, as you know, Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, in the Bible. Muhammad, has he been foretold and prophesied in the Bible? A subtitle would be Muhammad and the Religion of Islam, the Revelation of the Holy Quran, revealed by previous prophets. Now, a verse, because we might be concerned, and I'd like to say from the outset that this lecture is basically addressed to my Jewish and Christian friends. This is not a topic that we as Muslims are too overly concerned about. However, we have an interest in the topic, and I'll explain that shortly. But I want to make sure that my Jewish and Christian friends pay attention, and those of you who are here and those of you who will eventually see this videotape, to pay attention and to follow carefully what I present. Now, in the Quran, why is it important to us as Muslims to discuss this topic? And why is it important to you non-Muslims to understand the nature of this topic? In the Quran, along with the verse that our brothers recited here at the podium previously, there is an ayat, a verse of the Quran that says in chapter 7 of the Quran, verse 157, those who follow the messenger prophet, the Ummi, the unlettered one, whom they find mentioned in the Torah and the Injil. So therefore, the Quran is certifying that there is a messenger, a prophet, who has been mentioned in the Torah and the Injil, and that that prophet should be sought after, understood, identified, and followed, and obeyed. So we as Muslims, we have an obligation to present to you that individual, I would say a reference to him outside of Islamic sources. And so this is what we seek to do this evening. And why is it important to non-Muslims? Because in the Bible, as I'll get to this point, there is a verse speaking about this individual who we seek to identify as Muhammad that says, those who follow that prophet and those who reject that prophet will be chastised directly by God Almighty. So we'll come to that. So it's very important for us as Muslims to identify and present that prophet to you, and for you as non-Muslims to understand who that is and to follow that prophet. Now, again, I will use a method presenting this argument called in Arabic qiyas or analogy. In other words, because I'm not going to point directly to the name of this individual, but I'll use a method that is used that where you find traits of an individual that meet certain criteria that identifies that person. And why would I do that? Because we know as Muslims and Christians in particular know that they have used this methodology in order to identify Jesus, peace be upon him, as he has been foretold in Hebrew scriptures. I'll give an example. In John chapter 1, verse 45, John chapter 1, verse 45, and I'll be quoting primarily from the King James Version of the Bible for those who would like to follow suit. And if I deviate from that, I'll inform you. Now, in John chapter 1, verse 45, it says there, we have found him, this is Philip, coming to a person named Nathanael. And he tells him that we have found him, of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. However, if you look in any Hebrew writings, Old Testament writings, you will never find that phrase there. You'll never find the word Jesus, the name Jesus there. However, by identifying certain prophecies with this individual, Philip was able to identify and place the identity on Jesus, peace be upon him. His name is not there. Jesus' name is nowhere found in the Old Testament. However, our Christian brethren will tell you that he has been foretold there over and over again. Again, in Acts chapter 18, verse 28, this gentleman named Apollos, it says there, that he convinced the Jews publicly, shown by the scriptures, that Jesus was the Christ. Now, again, he was able to argue his case before Jews to show those Jews that Jesus was the Messiah, the Messiah that they awaited. However, his name is not there. I'm simply saying that because if someone would ask me to show the name of Muhammad in the Hebrew scriptures, we should not have to be obligated to do that. Although we can do it, but we don't have to. Now, Jesus stated in John chapter 5, verse 46, for had you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of me. Where are those writings? Where is his name? His name is not there. So this is called analytical deduction. We're going to analyze these prophecies and see if they fit Muhammad, if they fit Jesus, if they fit anyone else. Peace and blessings be upon them all. Now, when the Quran says, those who follow the messenger, the prophet whom mentioned in the Torah and the Injil, we don't have to find his name. Brother spoke earlier about Ahmed. We don't have to find his name. We're not obligated to do that. Now, first of all, what is a prophet? A prophet is a mouthpiece of God. And in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 9, it says there, then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put words in thy mouth. So these prophetic words are not mere predictions. A prophet is not a person who simply predicts things in the future, but he brings to pass what he foretells. What a prophet says must follow. It must follow. A person who predicts, he can predict something and it follows or it may not follow. Sometimes it's right, sometimes it's wrong, but what a prophet says must come to pass. And in the Bible, the first person to be called a prophet, mentioned as a prophet, not necessarily the first prophet, but the first one mentioned as a prophet, is Prophet Abraham, peace be upon him. So we'll begin our discussion with him. In Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, now the Lord has said unto Abram, get thee out of the country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto the land which I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, And I will bless them, bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now, I want to say again from the outset that I'm not here arguing any case pro or con against Isaac and his descendancy and the promise that God gave him in the Bible. I'm not discussing that issue, and I would agree with primarily most of what has been said there. I'm arguing the case of Ishmael and his descendancy, which we say leads to the prophethood of Muhammad. That's the track that I'll follow. So here we have God Almighty promising something to Abraham to make him a great nation. And something key in what was said there in verse 3 of Genesis 12, and I will bless them that bless thee and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now, this promise to bless Abraham was given long, long before either Isaac, Ishmael, or Isaac was born. Yet this description here fits the Muslims as a glove. I will bless them that bless thee. What is so unique about that? Here I have a Muslim prayer book. And in this prayer book, we as Muslims, over a billion Muslims in the world today, making prayers 5 times a day, blessing Abraham over 5 billion times a day. Every day, we are the ones who bless Abraham more than anyone else in the world. And we'll find this in our prayer right here. O Allah, bless Muhammad as thou didst bless Abraham and the followers, descendants of Abraham. So we do this over 5 billion times every day. It's obligatory for us to do that. Not saying that others don't do it, but I doubt if anyone else on the earth, a family of people, would bless Abraham more than Muslims. So you can see that when God says, I will bless them that bless thee, this fits our community as Muslims more than anyone else. And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. We know that Moses, peace be upon him, was a national prophet, came only to his people. And we know that Jesus, peace be upon him, was a national prophet who came only to his people. He says in Matthew chapter 15, verse 24, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And when he commissioned his disciples in Matthew 10, verses 5, 6, he says, go not into the way of the Gentiles or any city of the Samaritans into ye not, but go ye rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So his mission was limited. However, about Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace be upon him, in the Quran, chapter 7, verse 158, it says there, say, O mankind, surely I, the messenger of Allah, is saying, am a messenger to you all. O mankind, I am a messenger to you all. So therefore, when it says, in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed, this could only be through the prophethood of Muhammad. Now, in Genesis chapter 17, verse 18, I want to just build my argument here, so listen carefully. Genesis 17, 18, and Abraham said unto God, oh, that Ishmael might live before thee. This is a prayer that Abraham is making, that Ishmael, his only son at the time, might live before thee. What does it mean to live before God? In Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 1, Moses is addressing the Israelites. He says there, now therefore hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes and unto the judgments which I teach you for to do them that ye might live. Hearken unto the commandments of God, do them that in doing them you might live. And we note that Jesus, a certain lawyer came to Jesus and asked him, good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Listen to what Jesus says in Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 28, but I'll just give you briefly what he said. When the lawyer says, Jesus asked the gentleman, says, how readeth the law? What does the law say to do to have eternal life? And the lawyer told him that to keep the commandments in brief. And Jesus says, thou hast answered well, Do this and thou shalt live. Do that and you shall live. Just knowing it is no good, but to do that and you shall live. These statutes and judgments were the Torah, or what is known as the Halakha, or the what we call in Arabic or in Islam, the Sharia, the law, the way. And we find that the same thing is said in the Quran in chapter 8, verse 24. O you who believe, respond to Allah and His Messenger when He calls you to that which will give you life. What is that that He's calling you to that will give you life? The Quran and the Sunnah, the way of the Prophet, peace be upon him. So, oh, that Ismail might live before thee, meaning that he will have statutes and commandments that he will use as a guideline for his life, which will cause him to have life. Now, what about Abraham's prayer? Was it answered? Was this prayer answered? Yes, in Genesis chapter 17, verse 20, God says, as for Ishmael, I have heard thee. Behold, I have blessed him, and I will make him fruitful, and will multiply him exceedingly. 12 princes shall he beget, and I will make of him a great nation. This promise to multiply Abraham's seed is the same as was given to Hagar regarding Ishmael when she conceived him. Hagar, in Genesis chapter 16, verse 10, and the angel of the Lord said unto her, Hagar, I will multiply thy seed exceedingly, that it shall not be numbered for multitude. And in Genesis chapter 21, verse 13, speaking to Abraham, we read, and also of the son of the bondswoman, I will make a great nation, because why? He is thy seed. And God heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of God called to Hagar out of heaven and said unto her, what aileth thee, Hagar? Fear not, for God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad, and hold him in thine hand, for I will make him a great nation. And God was with the lad. It's very important to understand this, because some of our Christian brethren will tell us that the son that Abraham had from his wife Hagar was illegitimate in some sense. And so that he was not the seed of promise and so forth. Well, here we have God addressing Hagar directly, giving her revelation, and promising to bless her child. We couldn't see how God would do that and then have this child not be a legitimate child. A great nation. So the next point is, what makes a nation great? What makes the people great in the sight of God? Because I hear sometimes when I discuss this with friends, they say, well, you know, we don't deny that Ishmael and the Ishmaelites, the Arabs in the world today, they would point, oh, great nation, you know, they have this wealth and all this oil and all this business here. I'm asking now, is that what makes a nation great in the sight of God? When God said, I will bless him and make him a great nation. Let's take a look and see. What made the Israelites great? Because God had promised to make them great. In Exodus chapter 32, verses 9 and 10, God speaking to Moses says, I have seen this people to be, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and I will make them a great nation. God is promising to make the Israelites a great nation. What made them great? In Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 5 through 8, we'll take a look. We'll see what made them great. Deuteronomy chapter 4 begins, now, therefore, hearken, O Israel, unto the statutes, and unto the judgments which I teach you for to do them, that ye may live and go and possess the land which the Lord thy God gives you of your fathers. Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even as the Lord my God commanded me, that ye should do so in the land whither you go to possess it. Moses is telling his people now, keep therefore and do them, that this, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations, which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. For what nation is there so great who has God so near unto them as the Lord our God is in all the things that we call upon him for? And what nation is there that is so great that has statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law, this Torah, which I set before you this day? Only take heed to thyself and keep thy soul diligently, lest thou forget these things which thine eyes have seen, and lest they depart from thy heart all the days of thy life. Excuse me. But teach them to thy sons and thy sons' sons. So we see here that what made the Israelites a great people is the revelation of the Torah, the divine revealed law for them to follow and guide their lives by. That is what made them great in the sight of God. Now we read in Genesis chapter 18, verses 18 and 19, that the children of Abraham are told to keep those laws and that guidance that God had given them. And Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I know him, that he will keep my commandments, and his children and his household after him. And they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abram that which he has spoken of him. That is to make him a great nation. Concerning this, we read in the Quran, in chapter 2, verse 132. And the same did Abraham enjoin on his sons. And so did Jacob, O my son, surely Allah has chosen for you this religion, so die not unless you are Muslims. So, and also in 16:123 of the Quran, the Prophet of Islam, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was told to follow the religion of Abraham. Now, was Ishmael a legitimate son of Abraham? According to the Bible, in Genesis chapter 16, verse 2 to 3, Hagar was Abraham's legitimate wife. You can find that there. In Genesis 16:7-11, Ishmael was born according to divine prophecy. In Genesis 21:13, Ishmael was of the seed of Abraham. In Genesis 15:4, Ishmael was the legitimate heir to Abraham. We read in Deuteronomy 21:15-17 about the divine law of inheritance. And in Genesis 17:20, Ishmael was blessed by God and made the father of a great universal nation. So, what then made the Ishmael great? The same yardstick must be used to measure the greatness of the Ishmaelites as was made used to judge the greatness of the Israelites. We say it is the Sharia, the revelation of the Quran. And this we can see in Quran chapter 2, verse 10. There Allah says, certainly we have revealed a book to you which will give you eminence, which will make you great. We have revealed a book to you that will make you great. The same as was revealed to the Israelites. A Torah, a law, a divine code of conduct. And in the Quran chapter 43, verses 43 to 44, so hold fast to all that has been revealed to thee, for behold, thou art on a straight way. And verily, this revelation shall indeed become a source of eminence for thee and thy people. Now, a major prophecy is made in the Hebrew Scriptures. It's the greatest prophecy in all of the Bible. This prophecy is found in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, verses 15 and verse 18. It's the greatest prophecy in the whole of the Bible. Concerns a prophet like Moses. Now, Abraham was the first prophet mentioned by name, rather mentioned as a prophet, but the greatest prophet mentioned in the Bible was to be Moses in the Hebrew Bible. About this, we find in Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 10, There has not arisen a prophet since in Israel like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. So after Moses, no one had came of his stature. Moses was a leader, a deliverer, a liberator of his people, and a lawgiver. Now, the Quran says that Moses foretold the advent of a prophet like him. In the Quran, chapter 46, verse 10, say ye if it, meaning the Quran, is from Allah and you disbelieve in it, and a witness from among the children of Israel has borne witness of one like unto him. In Deuteronomy 18, 15, Moses speaking says, the Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee of thy brethren, like unto me, unto him ye shall hearken. That was Moses' speech. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18, God speaks now. God says, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee, and put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto you all that I command him. Goes on to say further in verse 19, and it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken to my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. This is the only place now where God is saying that he will personally intervene. Anyone who will not follow and obey that prophet who comes speaking words in the name of God that God has put in his mouth, that God himself personally will get involved. Now, five key points in this verse. Five key points. Listen at the verse. I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee, like you, Moses, and put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I command him. Now, first of all, we have to understand that this is not addressing the Jews by tribe. This is not addressing the Jews by tribe. This tribe as opposed to that tribe, meaning your brethren here. It's addressing the Jews as a whole, the Israelites as a whole, the whole of the people speaking to them about their brethren. God himself will send this prophet. God himself will not come. Christendom believes that Jesus is God incarnate, that God has come to the earth in the form of a man. So this cannot apply to Jesus. We have to make this clear to our Christian brethren. We will show our Jewish brethren how it cannot apply. Anyone that they identify, such as Joshua, they will tell us him. We'll come to that. But for our Christian brethren, this cannot apply to Jesus because God says he will then raise up this prophet. A prophet must be here, a mortal, fallible human being. And he must be from among the brethren of the Israelites. That means he will have ancestors. If Jesus is God and God incarnate, he doesn't have ancestors. God doesn't have ancestors. And the words must be put in his mouth. They can't be his own words. If Jesus is God, then the words that he spoke would be his own words. These words have to be put in the mouth of the individual. And he must speak all that he's commanded. And we know that Jesus has said according to the Bible that I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. For whatever reason it was, he didn't speak all. And he must be commanded by someone superior. A prophet like Moses must first of all be a mortal human being. The Christian belief that Jesus is God disqualifies him in total. Because this prophecy does not speak of an individual who has a dual nature. Our Christian brethren tell us that Jesus is both divine, fully divine, and fully human. So this prophecy cannot apply to him. If he's fully God or partially God, partially human, it's not applicable to him. And in John chapter 1, verse 1, we read there, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1, 14, it says that the Word became flesh and dwelt among the people. So unfortunately, our Christian brethren would like to adopt that prophecy for Jesus, peace be upon him. But they can't have that prophecy and hold on to the idea of Jesus being God incarnate. They'd have to sacrifice one or the other. I don't think they want to sacrifice the God incarnation doctrine. So they have to give up this prophecy being applicable to Jesus, peace be upon him. There's no two ways about it. And in Colossians chapter 2, verse 9, Paul says, for in him, meaning Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of Godhead bodily. This is not a prophet like Moses. A prophet like Moses, being a mortal human being, does in fact qualify the prophet of Islam, Muhammad, peace be upon him. In the Quran, chapter 21, verse 7, Allah declares, "And we sent not before thee any but men," meaning mortal human beings, "to whom we sent revelation. So ask the followers of the earlier revelation." And in 73:15 of the Quran, it says, "Surely we sent you a messenger as we sent a messenger to Pharaoh." So this prophet is being compared to Moses. Again, in 46:10 of the Quran, it says, "Say, if it is from Allah, if it is from Allah," meaning the Quran, "and a witness from among the children of Israel has borne witness of him." So here the identity is being likened to Moses, peace be upon him. The prophecy speaks about "of thy brethren." Both Moses and God are addressing the Israelites as a whole, saying "of thee and thy." How does this work? Give me an example again. In Matthew chapter 21, verse 43, for example, notice the way that Jesus addresses the Israelites as a whole when speaking to the chief priests and the Pharisees. He was talking to the priests and the Pharisees, but addressing the Israelites as a whole. Look at this language. Matthew 21, 43 says, "Therefore I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruit thereof." So he's addressing those people standing there, but he's talking about them as a whole people. You is representative of the Israelites as a whole. Thy brother would therefore be point to the Ishmaelites as a whole. So when God says, "I will raise up a prophet from among thy brethren," he's addressing them as a whole, the Israelites, talking about the Ishmaelites as a whole. And we'll clarify that further as we go along. If this prophet, like Moses, were to be an Israelite, the text would have said, "from among themselves, I will raise them up a prophet from among themselves," or "from among the children of Israel," not "from among their brethren." For example, in Isaiah chapter 66, verse 19 and 20, Jesus, we show you how things are being more specific now when addressing the Israelite people. Isaiah chapter 66, verses 19 and 20. "And I will set a sign among them, and I will send those that escape of them unto nations. And they shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord out of the nations, upon horses and chariots, in litters, and upon mules, and upon swift beasts, to my holy mountain Jerusalem, saith the Lord, as the children of Israel bring offerings of in clean vessels unto the house of the Lord." So here God is speaking about "as the children of Israel." He's talking about sending these people among their brethren of the nations, but this is not their brethren, the Israelites. When he wants to mention that, he makes it clear that the children of Israel. Give you another example. In Leviticus chapter 25, verses 45 and 46, "Moreover, of the children of the strangers that do sojourn among you, of them shall ye buy of their families that are with you, which they beget in your land, that they shall be your possession. And ye shall take them as inheritance for your children after you, to inherit them for a possession, that they shall be your bondsmen forever. But over your brethren, the children of Israel, ye shall not rule one of another with rigor." Your brethren, the children of Israel, being specified here. If that new prophet of Deuteronomy 18 was to come from the Israelites, the word "children of Israel" would have been used. Now notice how Stephen in Acts chapter 7 verse 23 refers to this incident. Now first of all, in Exodus chapter 2 verse 11, we have something stated there, kind of vaguely. Exodus 2:11, it says, "And it came to pass that in those days when Moses was grown, that he went out unto his brethren and looked on their burdens, and he spied an Egyptian smiting a Hebrew, one of his brethren." This tells about the incident where Moses went upon his people and he saw a fight that had broken out. And so he came to the defense of that individual and ended up killing someone. But it says there, "went out unto his brethren." So to requote this statement here and make it clear who the brethren are, Stephen in Acts chapter 7 verse 27 says, And when he was fully 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. He qualifies that. His brethren, the children of Israel. To let you know that these are the brethren we're talking about. The Israelites, not the Ishmaelites or anyone else. In Matthew chapter 23, verse 8, Jesus cautions his disciples, saying, "Be not ye called Rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and ye as a whole are brethren." Ye are brethren. Ye yourselves are brethren. By this, Jesus implies that he's more than just a mere brother to his disciples. So we don't want to pick him out and say he is of their brethren. He's making himself more than just that. About God putting words in his mouth. If Jesus was God, as I said before, the words he spoke would be his own. No one could put words in his mouth. Note also that the words of the gospel are not the words put into the mouth of one person. They represent the inspired words of many. The gospel are not that document that have been spoken by one individual. Example, Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 2. For as many has taken into hand to set forth a compilation in order to a declaration of those things which are mostly surely believed among us, this is what Luke says, it seemed good to me also to deliver them unto you. In other words, Luke is saying that he's not divinely inspired. He's not speaking words that have been put in his mouth. He's only undertaking an adventure to make a compilation of something that had already been being done by many other people. So the gospel accounts are not words put into the mouth of individuals. We'll separate that in a few minutes. We'll talk about the difference between revelation and inspiration as it relates to the Quran and the gospels. Now, about revelation put into the mouth of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Quran, chapter 53, verses 1 through 5, it says, "By the star when it sets, your companion errs not, nor does he deviate, nor does he speak out of desire. It is naught but a revelation that is revealed." It is naught but a revelation put in his mouth. This is what the Quran claims to be. The Quran claims to be the speech of the word of God, the word of God put into the mouth of the prophet, peace be upon him. So the speech of the prophet, when you recite this Arabic language, you're reciting the words of God. When he recited it, it was his speech, but the words of God that he was reciting. Unlike the Bible or any other book that we have today. And another point there, speak all that I command him. Again, if Jesus is God, and this prophet, like Moses, is Jesus, then we have two gods. If Jesus is God, and the prophet, like Moses, would be Jesus, according to our Christian brethren, then we would have two gods. God in heaven, shouting out commands to God on earth. Because he says he has to obey whatever I command him. So God in heaven, meaning the Father God, would be giving commands to God on earth, meaning the Son God. And he'd have to hear those commands and obey them. One God is superior in that he requires the other to speak all that he's commanded. Now Moses spoke all that he was commanded. Moses, Exodus chapter 7, verse 2. Muhammad, peace be upon him, and them all, spoke all, Quran chapter 5, verse 67 and 5:3. Jesus, as I said before, was not able to speak all. Or he didn't speak all. In John chapter 16, verse 12, he says, "I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now." Whether it be because time was limited or because the disciples were unable to comprehend, whatever the case might have been, it's not our problem. It's that he did not speak all according to their scripture. Did Jesus claim to be a prophet like Moses? Did he make that claim? In John chapter 7, verse 38, here we have Jesus saying, "He that believeth on me, as the scripture said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of water." Many of the people, therefore, when they heard this saying, said, "Of a truth, this is the prophet." They heard Jesus say that. And so they said, "Of a truth, this is that prophet," meaning the prophet of Deuteronomy 18:18, the prophet like Moses, what the people said. Others said, "This is the Christ," meaning the Messiah, the Mashiach. But some said, "Shall Christ come out of Galilee?" So there was a division among the people about him. In other words, when Jesus made this statement, some people listened and said, oh, he must be that prophet of Deuteronomy 18, the prophet like Moses that we expected. Other people said, no, he must be the Christ. So there was a division about who he was. Either he was the prophet like Moses or the Christ. We're asking now, did Jesus decide that matter? Did he solve that dilemma for the people? Was this division among the people had regarding Jesus, was it decided? Was he a prophet like Moses, or was he the Christ? In Matthew chapter 16, verse 13 through 17, we're told there, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said unto him, some say that thou art John the Baptist, and some say Elias, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets, meaning one, maybe even the one like Moses. He said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said unto him, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Bar-Jonas, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. What does it mean here is that there was some question. Jesus was asking his disciples, since they were people frequenting the marketplace more often, what are the people saying? Who are they saying that I am? And he was saying, his disciples told him, well, some people think that you're Elias. Some people think that you're Elijah. Some people think you're John the Baptist or one of the prophets. He said, well, who do you say that I am? And Peter answered, he said, look, you are the Messiah. And Jesus said, blessed are you, Peter. You didn't just think that up yourself, but God revealed that to you to say that's who I am. So Jesus claimed that he was the Messiah. He was not that prophet like Moses. He was a prophet Messiah. So according to God who revealed it to Peter, and surely God is the best knower, Jesus was not that prophet like Moses or even one of the prophets. He was, according to God, the Christ, the prophet Messiah. Also in the Quran we read, in Quran chapter 3, verse 44, when the angel said, oh Mary, surely Allah gives you good news of a word from him of a son who shall be called Christ Jesus, the son of Mary, the Messiah. So the Quran says that Jesus, peace be upon him, was the Messiah. And God revealed, according to the Bible, to Peter that Jesus was the Messiah. He was not that prophet like Moses. Gonna take another break. This title Jesus wore as the Messiah until the day that he departed from his disciples. When asked by the Jews in John chapter 10, verse 24, the Jews asked him, if thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. And he says, I told you, but you believe not. He still held up that he was the Christ, the Messiah. Again, when he was asked by the high priest, in Mark chapter 14, verse 61, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? And Jesus answered, I am. And the woman of Samaria, we're told in John chapter 4, verse 19, and John chapter, verses 19 and 24 and 25, the woman at the well, the woman said unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. I perceive that you're a prophet. I just want to ask you something else, though. Prophet, I understand. She says, the woman said unto him, I know that the Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he has come, he will tell us all things. Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto you am he. I'm he. You perceive that I'm a prophet, I'm also the Messiah that you're waiting. I'm he. So, Jesus was the prophet Messiah, not the prophet like Moses who will speak all. Now, for our Jewish brethren, who would allude to some biblical, some Old Testament prophet, or some prophet from Hebrew scriptures, because they would tell us sometimes that, well, this prophecy was about Joshua, because he eventually led the people into the promised land. Well, we can argue that issue from their scripture, but just in case anyone would bring it, we say that this prophecy, according to the New Testament, was still being waiting waiting to be fulfilled. In John chapter 1, verses 19 through 21 and 25, we see that that prophet up until that time had not come. We told you in Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 10, that it was said there that there had not arisen a prophet in Israel like unto Moses. Now, in John chapter 1, verse 19, the Jews are still waiting that prophecy, that prophet. And don't forget that the Jews were waiting three great prophets, prophecies to be fulfilled. They were waiting. They had been told that Elijah had been taken up to heaven in a whirlwind, and that before the great and dreadful day of the Lord, as a sign of the coming hour, that Elijah would come back. And they were waiting for the Messiah. And they were also waiting for the prophet of Deuteronomy 18:18, that great prophet who was so well known, his name didn't have to be mentioned. So waiting for Elijah, the same person, waiting for the Messiah, and waiting for the prophet of Deuteronomy 18 like Moses. So those three great prophecies, fulfillment was being awaited. Now we have the situation here in the fourth gospel. The fourth gospel, the gospel according to John, that was supposedly written some 100 years or so after the time of Jesus, the prophecy is still being waited fulfillment here. And this is the record of John. John chapter 1, verses 19, 21, and 25. And this is the record of John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites to Jerusalem to ask him. Now this is John the Baptist. He's supposed to be in prison at the time. And the Jews, seeing the work that he had did, was wondering if he might have been the Messiah or who was he. So they sent a delegation to him to ask him some questions. And they asked him. And he answered and confessed not. And confessed but denied not. I am not the Christ. He said, I'm not the Christ. In case you think I'm the Christ, I'm not him. And in John chapter 3, verse 28, John the Baptist had already reminded his disciples, you yourselves bear witness that I said I am not the Christ. His disciples already told his people, I'm not the Christ, in case you think I am. So when these other people come and ask, he says, I'm not the Christ. They asked him, what then art thou, Elias? And he said, I am not. And they asked him, art thou that prophet? And he said, no. And they asked him and said unto him, why baptizest thou if thou be not the Christ, nor Elias, or that prophet? In other words, if you're not the Christ, if you're not Elias, and you're not that prophet, why are you baptizing? Now, we have already said that God told Peter who the Christ was, that Jesus, peace be upon him, was the Christ. That was one of the personalities there. Jesus is the Christ. And Jesus himself told his disciples in Matthew chapter 17, verse 12, let me just read it into the record here. Matthew chapter 17, verse 12. 12 and 13, I believe it is. Let's take a look and see. But I say unto you that Elias is to come, has come already, and they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they like, they liken. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer. Then the disciples understood that he spoke to them of John the Baptist. So our Christian brothers might say, well, that was their understanding. It doesn't mean it was true. They understood that. So further on, we'll read in Matthew chapter 17, verse 12. I'm sorry. Matthew chapter 11, verse 13 and 14. For all the prophets and the law prophesied unto John. This is Jesus' word. And if you will receive it, this is Elias, which was for to come. So Jesus now is telling his disciples that John the Baptist was, in fact, Elias. In other words, his spirit and power, that he represented Elias. So God has told Peter by revelation, and Jesus himself has owned up when questioned, that he was the Messiah. And Jesus says that John was Elias. So now, who was that prophet of Deuteronomy 18:18? That prophecy is still being waited to be fulfilled. The prophet like Moses, who God will put words in his mouth. It can't be Jesus. So if our Christian brethren would like to point to someone else, they're free to do that, but they have to stop now saying that it was Jesus, peace be upon him. It wasn't him. Now, again, Paul contrasts. He contrasts Jesus with Moses. And just to make it clear into the record, the term contrast means to show the dissimilarity between two things, the unlikeness. So this is what Paul did. He placed them side by side to show that one was unlike the other. God said he's going to raise a prophet like Moses. Paul is going to show you that Jesus is unlike Moses. In Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, this is supposed to be divine revelation, so we have to trust it somewhat. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our possession, Christ Jesus, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. He's telling his the people here, consider Jesus now who was faithful unto God, the same way that Moses was faithful unto God and being appointed. Now, in the house of God. So now he wants to set them apart now. They were both faithful, but here's where they differ. For this man, Jesus, was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who had built the house had more honor than the house. For every house has a builder, as built by some man, but he that built that built all things is God. And Moses barely was faithful in all his house. What a slave. He says that Moses was a slave in the house for a testimony to those things which were spoken by spoken after. But Christ as a son over his house, over his own house. In other words, he says that Christ, being the Son of God, inherited ownership. So as Moses was in the house of God as a slave of God, a servant of God, Jesus was in the house of God as owner. So he wants to show there's a big difference between them. So Jesus is not like Moses then, according to what Paul has just said here. And in a piece of literature called The Complete Biblical Library, it says here, a commentary on that verse, it says, the writer of Hebrew was not trying to portray Moses in a negative light. Rather, Moses was being contrasted with Jesus in order to show that Christ is greater than Moses. Whereas Moses was a slave, verse 5, Christ is a son, verse 6. Whereas Moses served in God's house, verse 5, Christ is over God's house, verse 6. They're two different. This is their words. So Moses is here clearly classified by God as a slave, responsible and accountable to God as a subordinate, not born in the family. Now, Jesus himself contrasts himself with Moses, says that he's not like Moses. This prophet is supposed to be a prophet like Moses. In John chapter 6, verses 31 to 35, Jesus there says, he's telling the Jews, our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it was written. And you'll find that written in Psalms chapter 78, verses 24, Exodus 16, 4, and 15. Our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it is written, for he gave them that bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but the bread of God is he which comes down from heaven and giveth you life unto the world. Then said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. So according to Jesus himself, he's not simply a prophet like Moses. He is the life-giving source. Moses gave the people bread from heaven, but they ate the bread and they died. But Jesus says he's the bread that came down from heaven. Partaking of him gives life. So in this language, he has separated himself from Moses. He's not a prophet like Moses. Now, Moses was given a divine law. Muhammad, peace be upon him, was given a divine law and both judged by that law. But in sharp contrast, Jesus did not think of himself as a lawgiver. Jesus didn't see himself as a lawgiver. Give an example, inheritance laws. They're set forth by Moses in Numbers chapter 27, verses 1 through 11, Deuteronomy 21, 15 to 17. Inheritance laws are set forth by Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Quran, chapter 5, verse 104. But Jesus stated his role did not involve handling legal matters of property division. In Luke chapter 12, verse 13 and 14, a disciple came to Jesus and asked him, Master, speak to my brother that he divide the inheritance with me. They asked him, Jesus, can you talk to the guy that he divide this inheritance with me? And Jesus said unto him, Man, who made me a judge or a divider over you? Who made me that? I'm not a judge or a divider over you. I can't settle that. You have to go and talk to somebody in the courts about that business. Here Jesus makes it clear that his mission was not to solve legal matters or problems, but to deal with sin problems, unlike Moses and Muhammad. Peace be upon them both and upon them all. God made both Moses and Muhammad rulers and deliverers. About Moses, we read in Acts chapter 7, verse 27. When Moses intervened in a dispute and was asked, he was asked. When Moses got involved in this problem, he was asked. Somebody asked him, who made you a ruler and a judge over us? They asked Moses that. And the answer in Acts chapter 7, verse 35, this Moses whom they refused, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge? The same that God sent to be a ruler and a deliverer by the hand of the angel God which appeared to him in the bush. So God made him a ruler and a judge. Muhammad was made, peace be upon him, a ruler and a judge by Allah in the Quran, chapter 5, verse 48. So judge between them by what Allah has revealed. Also a ruler in Quran 14, 13 and 14. If Jesus was the promised prophet, like Moses, no prophet could come after him, because this prophet was to be the final prophet as well. He was to speak all and to guide into all truth. No prophet could come after him. Was there, according to the Bibles, a prophet after Jesus? And this is crucial also, because our Christian brethren, if they reject the prophet of Islam, the prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as a prophet, well, the Bible has left the door open for prophets to come after Jesus, peace be upon him. Not so in Islam. We know in Islam that the prophet of Islam was the final prophet. No prophet can come after him. So anyone claiming that they are a prophet of God is simply not a prophet of God. They have no revelation. They have nothing to vouch for that. But however, it's not so with Christendom. They have left the door open. So if Jesus was that prophet, no prophet could come after him. Was there, according to the Bible, a prophet of God after Jesus? Yes. Acts chapter 21, verses 10 to 11. The prophet's name was Agabus, A-G-A-B-U-S. The author of the Acts records that while Paul and his company visited at the home of Philip, it says, there came down from Judea a certain prophet named Agabus. And when he was commanded unto, and when he came unto us, he took Paul's girdle and bound his own hands and feet and said, thus said the Holy Ghost, so shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man of this, who owns this girdle, and shall deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. So this prophet here is a legitimate prophet based on the biblical scriptures. Why? Because he's prophesying by the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is inspiring him to make this statement. This is what it says here. The prophet spoke by the Holy Ghost, and his prophecies were true. They were fulfilled. This happened to Paul, according to the scripture. Therefore, Jesus was not the last prophet. It says also in Acts chapter 11, verse 27, 28, and in these days came a prophet from Jerusalem unto Antioch, one of them named Agabus, and signified by the Spirit, by the Holy Ghost, that there should be a great famine throughout all the world, which came to pass in the days of Claudius Caesar. So this was a prophet who spoke by the Holy Ghost, and the things came to pass. So Jesus, peace be upon him, according to the Bible, was not the last prophet. And Jesus, according to the Bible, did not guide into all truth. So the Bible does not guide into all truth. There has to be an external source to guide these people into all truth. That prophet is the one that we're identifying now. Now, the paraclete, you've heard about this term, paraclete. And this is mentioned in John chapter 14, 16, John 14, 26, John 15, 26, John 16, 7, and 1 John 2, 1, the paraclete. The paraclete was to continue the work of the historical Jesus. In John chapter 14, verse 16, the paraclete is the successor of Jesus, who himself is called a paraclete. Here's what Jesus now made the prophecy. Jesus made the same prophecy when I talked about a great prophet a great prophecy, the greatest of all the Bible prophecies. Here Jesus is reiterating now and the same prophecy, just in a little different terms, but the same prophecy of Deuteronomy 18, Jesus now is making that same prophecy. John chapter 14, 15, and 16. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. Now, in arguing this situation with our Christian brethren, it's key to understand the term another. There's a Greek word used there, another, to be the choice of two words, to be another of the same kind, another of a different kind. Two different words are used. Allos, Greek word for another of the same kind. Heteros, Greek word of another of a different kind, where you get the word heterosexual from. So, which word did Jesus use? Did he mean another mortal, fallible human being like himself? Or did he mean the Holy Ghost to come of a different kind, a spirit? Another comfort implies that comforters had already passed also, had already come and gone. And that only, as we shall see later, after his death, meaning Jesus' departure, another would come that would last forever. Now, had paracletes, had comforters come already? Yes. In Job chapter 33, verse 23, angels and interpreters were paracletes. In Job chapter 16, 2, this speaks about miserable comforters. In Exodus 32, 11, Moses was a paraclete. In 1 John 2, 1, Jesus was a paraclete. In Mark chapter 13, 11, the Holy Ghost was a paraclete, even before the alleged death and resurrection of Jesus. And in John 14, 16, Jesus prophesied another paraclete, another advocate. And in John chapter 16, verse 13, this advocate is also known as he, the Spirit of Truth. Now, if you look in Exodus, I said, Exodus chapter 32, verse 11, and you read the heading there, if you have a Bible that has a heading, it says there, the advocacy of Moses. And they refer you to 1 John 2, 1. That term there is parakletos there. And it's the same thing used for Moses, that Moses was a paraclete, an advocate. And John, where Jesus speaks about, where Jesus is being spoke about, is a paraclete. So Jesus is praying for another of the same kind. 1 John 2, 1, it says, 1 John, not John chapter 2, 1 John chapter 2, 1, it says, my little children, these things I write unto you that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. So John is telling people, don't sin. But if you sin, you have a go-between. You have someone who can mediate your case for you. Jesus Christ. We as Muslims, we don't have anything like that. We don't have any mediators or anything. We can pray directly to God and have our prayers answered. And in fact, Christianity has the same thing, but they have taught themselves differently. Jesus taught his disciples, when you pray, our Father who art in heaven, help directly to God. They have made this mediator business among themselves. Now, question, could the Holy Ghost be this paraclete? In Luke chapter 11, verse 13, the Holy Ghost is declared to be a gift of God. If ye then, Jesus says, if ye then being evil, talking to the Jews, if ye then being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit, give the gift of the Holy Spirit to them that ask? How can the third person of the Trinity, if they say that the Trinity consists of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, how can the third person of the Trinity be a gift of the first person? They are supposed to be of the same equality, of the same age, of the same authority. That would be like God Almighty giving God Almighty to mortals. Now, another, the term allos versus heteros. Another in English carries more than one meaning. Two Greek words for another are used in this verse, in the Bible, rather. Another of a different kind, another of the same kind. The point is, which one did Jesus use? In John chapter 16, 14, verse 16. Now, an example of how this word is used, another, in Galatians chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. Both words are used there. And here Paul says, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him who called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. He's telling his disciples there, those people in Galatia, he says, look, you know, I just got through talking to you about the doctrine that I'm teaching you. Yet, as soon as I leave you, somebody else comes along, and now you're changed doing something different. So he says, I marvel how soon you have changed to another gospel. Here the Greek word is heteros. Then he goes on to say in verse 7, which is not another, he says, allos, not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. So he's using both words there, heteros and allos. Now, we want to know which word did Jesus, which meaning and which word did Jesus use when he prayed for another comforter? Because I said in English, when you ask for another something, it's just one word. If I'm having lunch at your house, and I said, look, you know, can you bring out some more of those cookies? I'd like to have another cookie. However, I'm allergic to chocolate. And so you had some oatmeal cookies or something, you brought them, and then they were all out, so you came out with a chocolate cookie. And I said, no, I don't eat them. He says, well, you asked for another cookie. I said, no, I meant another of the same kind, another oatmeal. So I have to specify here. You see, because another just means another. Here you have two different words. If you want a different kind, you say heteros. If you want the same kind, you say allos. Jesus used the word allos here. It's in the Greek text, and we can show that. John chapter 8, verse 40. Now, what kind was Jesus? What kind, what was his person? Because our Christian brethren tell us that he has two natures. When we argue, is Jesus God? They say, well, he's both fully God and fully man. I said, well, show me a word in the Bible that identifies that nature. What word can I see that I can say that he's fully God and fully man? There's no word. So I said, well, let me show you a word that rejects that. And here it is in John chapter 8, verse 40. To show what kind Jesus was. That's another kind is what he wants, the same thing. He says there, but now you seek to kill me, a man, anthropos, that's the term, where you get to study anthropology. A man, a mortal, fallible human being with one nature, just like we have. A man that has told you the truth, which I heard from God. Now, in Luke chapter 24, verse 39, Jesus says, behold my hands and my feet, that is I myself, handle me and see, for a spirit has no flesh and bones as you see me have. In the Gospel of John, we're told that God is a spirit.